This is Jihyun Lee. She's the second presenter here. The names are very similar, so but nationalities I don't think are. Are you Chinese? Yeah, okay. She's Korean. Okay. I don't think the time was in it. I thought that Chris was going to introduce me.
No.
I don't think that anybody needs to introduce me. You've seen me around at ISTEC and some of the things at these meetings in the past. Jihyun will talk in the middle. I will talk at the beginning and the end. And everything that, the reason why I decided to talk about this book of ours is because Phil reminded me to his talk 3 weeks ago about some of the things that we are doing that might be related, probably very vaguely, but it might be of interest to at least some of you to see what we have found. Let me go on. I used to work 10 years ago or so, both in fact, Jihyun and I worked at the Educational Testing Service, or ETS as it is sometimes called, for a few years. That is the largest testing organization in the world, about 3,000 people, about 300 PhDs working for them. They developed TOEFL, they developed SAT, which is much better known in America than elsewhere. They developed NAEP, which many people here don't know about, but it is a predecessor of many of the large-scale assessments that we now have around the world. And in fact, PISA is TIMSS in particular was a copy of some of the work that ETS did in the past, but it has all evolved. And we were working in what was then known as the New Construct Center, and basically that the way I see it, it was introduced as a homage to Sam Messick, who way back about 20 years, 30 years ago, was in charge of ETS and who has some major work in the area of validity related to his presidential position. And he coined the term non-cognitive, and that term, as Phil said, is being used quite a bit nowadays. And he talks about non-cognitive traits or dispositions, and he also, the aim of the center that I was in is to look at this link between non-cognitive traits and achievement. That is the main production line of the ETS. So the idea was to keep that link going. Lee published a paper inspired by the new construct spirit about the pretty large scale analysis and report on the not really meta-analysis, but just a review of the links between non-cognitive skills and achievement. That was published in 2010, and at the beginning of this century, as you know, there have been several other people, quite a few, in fact, coming from the economics. Heckman, from what I understand, is a Nobel Prize winner in economics, who, in fact, I was told, knows more about educational assessment than many people, or perhaps all of us put together in this room. There are some major, Phil might agree with this, but some other people may disagree with it. Anyhow, he was a major force in trying to look at non-cognitive links to performance. One of his collaborators is Angela Duckworth, who spent some time at the ETS, we were there, looking at those links. Basically, it all is related to economists being interested in what they called or think tanks in America producing several major reports and outlines of what are the 21st century skills in their opinion, given that the economic lifestyle that we have, or your lifestyle is changing, what are the skills that we should know now focus on. They rediscovered some of the skills that psychologists, when I was young and beautiful, in 1960s. In 1960s, we did some work. My first work was in the area of creativity and critical thinking, inspired by Gifford's work and some of the work in America that was a reaction to the Sputnik. And some of these guys who were on the think tank were probably students of Guilford's or somebody like that. So they rediscovered critical thinking and creativity. That's why a lot of people nowadays are talking about. But there were other things that they mentioned. One of them was collaborative work. How do we assess the group work, and how do we put groups together in order, because a lot of decision making nowadays is based on this kind of work. So this, and that is what ETS is doing right now, developing measures of collaborative work. And we were also, Jihyun and I were set into this framework, and we were looking also at some large scale assessment that had background questionnaires. Each one of TIMSS and PISA have background questionnaires quite often. She will tell you more about it. A large set of questions related to learning and so on that each participant, usually people pay attention to the RIGS. Tables of this country is good, this country is not. Very little attention is paid to background questionnaires. We have started doing it after Jihyun and Val Schulte published that work, looking seriously at the questions and linking them to performance. So when I say non-cognitive, it is broadly defined. It usually, in our way of thinking, does not include demographics, even though, as we know, some demographic variables are linked to non-cognitive and linked. It is usually what we have as psychological traits, but some people treat demographic variables as well as aspects of the demographic as non-cognitive. That was at TTS. Then I went to Singapore in 2008, and I was given the chance to do some work along these lines. And most of the work that I did was after adapting PISA, in fact, questionnaires on some of those aspects, and I was using them in Singapore, plus some of the other things that I was interested in. In particular, as you can see there, I was interested in comparing Confucians and Europeans with respect to some of the measures of personality, well-being, psychopathology, social attitudes, and parental styles. I do have a paper called Unforgiving Confucian Culture that got me into a little bit of trouble, not too much. But so there was that side of it. But I was particularly interested in looking at the non-cognitive predictors of achievement in addition to those on the top. In particular, the focus was on three measures from PISA, directly taken from PISA. They were self-efficacy measures. Now, in PISA, the self-efficacy measures are particular. You ask a person whether they can do a particular task. Can you calculate the square footage of this room? And if you say yes, or you can say on a range, I'm sure, and so on, like a scale, then you're not given that task. You're just asked, do you think you can do that? So it is an item-based self-efficacy. I can do it, basically, but I can do a particular task. And then you have measures of anxiety, mathematics anxiety, self-concept, and confidence, which is not a part of PISA. It is the work that I have been interested in over the past 20 years. But I see all these as self-beliefs measures. And in some work in Singapore that we carried out, they do tend to define as common factors. Okay, so there's a trait of self-beliefs that is different for personality trait. Not enough studied. Some of the work here, of the group here, was influential in bringing this out, as you all know. And what I think is the next step, probably what we are doing, is to understand the nature of this factor. Not just self-efficacy, not just anxiety, but to understand what is in common there, because they are obviously, as you will see today, very important from predicting achievement, and achievement is the most important thing for life, they're cognitive, but you might argue about that, but I will come back and argue. Okay, so in 2013, actually in 2012, I wrote a paper that got me a bit worried, because at that time I was negotiating with Ronda to join this group. And the paper has to do with my attempt to summarize the data that we have collected in these various studies that we carried out, both in America and Australia, prior to going there, and also Singapore, and see what are the variables that correlate little and what are the variables that correlate a lot with academic achievement. And I talk about it as a non-cognitive predictability hypothesis or gradient. It is not a theory, as I'm concerned, but we have now, I think, enough data to make some statements about what is important in education on the basis of the questionnaires and what is not, and if you're interested in achievement, that we should pay attention to it. They are important for questionnaire designs, take out those that are lowly correlated. They are probably important for theories, educational theory. Those that are lowly correlated should not be talked about in educational textbooks as much as they have been. What are the things that we have? Learning strategies from PISA, depression, which comes out from my work with some of the Singaporean group interested in depression and its relationship to various things in life, including achievement, well-being, sorry, Felicia, but it did not correlate at all with the scores on the test. Motivation, both intrinsic and extrinsic. When I got that, I said to myself, oh, well, of course, kids are committing suicides. We don't need to motivate them anymore than what they are doing. Just look in Singapore, in Korea, a huge number of people are, in fact, committing suicide. Why focus on that in particular? And measures of toughness and modesty that come from my work on militant extremism also do not correlate with it. Let me go. Here are the measure, the correlations that we had in one of the studies. You can see personality measures do not correlate with any of the achievements. They were in fact designed in relation to IQ tests. So they are different from IQ tests. Why would they correlate very much? Apart from perhaps some of our work on openness and some of the other people's work that I don't believe much, conscientiousness also correlates. So up to 35 correlations, I'll mention some of the measures that we looked at and are not very often looked in education. Measures of rationality. Stanovich, Heath, and West have done a lot of work, probabilistic and scientific reasoning, decision making, and clinical populations, thinking dispositions. They all tend to have a correlation up to 35. Self-reported assessment of intelligence also correlates up to 35. These are not zero correlations, they are minimal. Then you have openness to experience that I mentioned, and there is academic self-concept as well. Since I was negotiating at the time with Rod, I was very worried because self-concept did not come on top of all the predictors. It was in our work about up to 35. Larger than 0.35 correlations were with anxiety, that's anxiety. Now what I want to mention before I forget is that anxiety is not something that is linked to the task itself. Measures of anxiety are like personality measures. You have to say how scared you are. You don't have to say you work on that item and that is like this mathematics self-efficacy that we have here. This is the same thing. And larger than 0.45 in our work are the correlations with measures of confidence. And I will come back to it at the end and tell you more about it, about the outcomes of that work. Jihyun will now tell you about our attempt to find out whether the TIMSS and PISA data support the predictability gradient hypothesis that I saw as being important.
Okay, so this part of the presentation, I'm going to show you our analysis based on these five large-scale data sets. I started doing this work since 2004, and back then I didn't think that I would do it forever, but it seems like I'm doing it forever. So the goal here is to find out which non-cognitive variables will show the best predictability of the student achievement. Okay, so you're probably a little bit familiar with PISA, so I'll give you a little bit of overview of TIMSS. So TIMSS is very similar to PISA, but it started earlier than PISA. So TIMSS is Trends in International Studies of Mathematics and Science Studies. So it has two portions, mathematics and science. And it started from 1995 and up till now. And as you can see, the number of countries raised from 46 now 63. And as Lazar mentioned, there is a background questionnaires in TIMSS, and there are a lot of variables and what we call as non-cognitive constructs are included in the background questionnaire. These are some of the constructs that are measured in TIMSS. So we'll take a look at it more closer later. And a little bit, just brief overview of PISA. PISA studied 2000, and each year there's a focal subject area from reading, mathematics to science, and rotate every 3 years. And the background questionnaire of that particular year is actually linked to the assessment and learning of the particular subject area. So for instance, 2003, the background questionnaire is about learning of mathematics. And again, 2012, the background questionnaire is about learning of mathematics. So the little bit of structure of PISA, there are about 2 hours of cognitive assessment, which consists of reading, mathematics, and science, and 30 minutes of student questionnaire. And usually there's about 10 minutes of special questionnaire from the students, and about 30 minutes from the school questionnaire. And it started from 2000, now 2012, and I bet the results of PISA 2015 will come out at the end of this year. So now it's 65 countries participating in PISA, and you can see that now virtually every country minus Africa and India and China is participating in PISA. Okay, so these are some of the example variables of non-cognitive constructs measured in PISA 2012. So here you can see anxiety, self-concept, self-efficacy, all that Laza included in his own study as well. And there are about 10 variables also that the teacher's non-cognitive aspects of teaching, and so this is responses from students. Okay, so I just go to the analysis part. So basically, we analyzed PISA 2003 and PISA 2012 and TIMSS 2011, 2007, and 2003. And this is actually one paper, and I work with Laza a lot of times because it could write 5 papers, but he wanted to put it in 1 paper. So it's 1 paper. And there are about 70 different independent variables. Basically, we put everything together from those 5 large-scale assessment variables. Yes, it was a lot of work. Basically, about 70 scale level variables actually coming from more than 2,000 item level responses. And believe it or not, actually, I looked them all very carefully. And dependent variable, we have it as a mathematics achievement. Actually, the data has reading and science too. Actually, we analyze mathematics and science and reading, but the results quite very, very similar. So we take the mathematics as a proxy of students' achievement. And that comes to a sample size of more than 1.5 million students around the world. Okay, so statistical analysis we did was very simple, simple enough for us. So it's basically correlations, and we sort of reduced the number of variables based on correlations to feed them into HLM, because obviously we can't really put 70 into HLM. So basically we did pan-cultural analysis of correlation, treating each individual data set as individual and not considering the country membership. And then we also did the correlations of the within country, and then there are too many countries, so actually we averaged them. And then we did also the correlation based on the country aggregates, basically just the aggregate at the country level, and then we did the correlation between the two constructs. And then that fit into the 18-level analysis. Okay, so we did this analysis for each data set. So this is a like threshold that we kind of like arbitrarily set, that we would consider 0.20 as showing some pattern. That's just some pattern is that vague, but we just treat it as enough pattern in social science. And correlations lower than 0.20 is quite very small. Okay, so the result is, this is the result actually. So only 10 out of 43 has a correlation larger than 0.20 in TIMSS, in PISA, and in TIMSS only 5 out of 24 shows correlation larger than 0.20. And you may think that, oh, that's not bad, but it's really bad actually, because those 43 were chosen by the committees and all these countries as the strong, so-called strong predictors of student achievement, right? And TIMSS too, those 24 non-cognitive variables are chosen as potentially very, sort of very strong correlates of the student's achievement. And out of those 24, only 5, and out of those 43, only 10 shows a correlation larger than 0.20. So what are those 10? So this comes from PISA. So these are the 10 variables that showed correlation larger than 0.20. So we highlight a little bit of the green and yellow. So basically, there is a dominance of the SES variables. Those are home positions and parental education. And another group of variables that show quite high correlation is self-beliefs, self-efficacy, aspiration, self-concept, and anxiety. And the other one that also showed okay correlation is whether the student repeated grade or not. So, yeah, and as you can see, the result is quite consistent between, let's say, pan-cultural analysis between 2003 and 2012. The size of the correlations are really strikingly similar. It's making our lives worth living by looking at the data like this. Actually, I mentioned in the earlier slides, in 2003, there are only 41 countries. In 2012, there were 65 countries, meaning there were actually 25 countries added in 2012, and then still producing quite similar results between 2003 and 2012. And I think this is very powerful results. Yeah, and the other pattern that we found out is that the direction of the correlations are the same for 8 of them, and 2 of them, as you can see, there are 2 of them actually showing the different direction of correlations at the individual level versus country level. Those 2 are obviously self-concept and aspiration, meaning that the countries who are higher on self-concept actually score lower in mathematics, and aspiration the same pattern. So please just remember this because it's a mirror finding from TIMSS. This is TIMSS, but I just mentioned only 5 out of 24 showing correlation decent. And here again, the socioeconomic status and self-beliefs. This is exactly the same variable. Actually, we didn't really manipulate at all. Actually, it just comes out to be like totally same result between PISA and TIMSS. So here again, the student aspiration and self-concept. In TIMSS, actually in TIMSS data, they label that scale as confidence. But when I actually take a look at the scale and then items, what they call confidence is actually almost identical to PISA's self-concept. So the basically TIMSS confidence is actually PISA's self-concept. So the same pattern about the same size of correlations, again also between the individual and between the individual level analysis and between country level analysis, students' aspiration and self-concept actually the direction reversed. Yeah. All right, so I have to repeat. So that actually fitted into the HLM analysis. I think you guys can all read numbers, so I don't have to read the numbers, but these coefficients are standardized, so you can compare the effect sizes. And knowing what I just show you in the correlation size, it does, you know, result from the HLM is not very surprising. The efficacy shows the strongest association with mathematics, and followed by anxiety and repeat. And then the size is quite actually smaller from SES compared to the self-efficacy. And when we put efficacy and anxiety together, the self-concept actually quite reduced, but still significant. That's individual level correlates and coefficients. And at the country level, we actually put them together, but at the country level, there were only two variables that were significant at the predicting countries' mathematics achievement. Those two are home positions and self-concept. Yeah, only two. The others were not significant at the country level. So here again, as you can see, the home positions at the country level has a positive association, but the self-concept has negative association with the achievement. So quite actually, it's very, very consistent with the, I mean, it has to be very consistent with the correlation results. And as you can see, the results are quite consistent between 2003 and 2012. And knowing this, you can imagine the result from TIMSS is very, very similar. Here again, the confidence or self-concept and aspiration turn out to be the best predictors of students' achievement, which was actually stronger than home positions and parental education. And here again, at the country level, home positions and confidence and self-concept were the only two predictors, strong predictors of students' mathematics achievement at the country level. And as you can see here, the coefficient thought and coefficient direction has changed from between the home position and self-concept. The one is positive, one is negative. So I'll just show you what predicts the strongly of the student achievement, but as you can imagine, there are a lot of things that showed correlation almost near zero. Valuing, I don't know why valuing doesn't correlate, but valuing even parental involvement and attitude towards school didn't predict the student achievement almost at all. And similarly, PISA too, there are so many variables actually that within there that didn't correlate with the achievement almost at all. So that's it from my part. And that's about the team.
Thank you. Thank you, Jihyun. As you can see, what impressed us, or me, was that self-beliefs are extremely important, and they are as strong, if not stronger, than usually looked at socio-economic state. So I used to call this very jokingly this paper psychology beats sociology, but it is not really quite the same. I don't know why he's smiling. let me go on. Now, this might be more related to what Phil was talking last week. I want to talk about anchoring vignettes that were used in PISA 2012, and the data is available. We looked at it. This is a scoring method used to modify negative correlations at the country level so that they have the same sign as the variables at the individual level. Remember, they call that sometimes paradox, or positive at the individual, negative on the country level. And that is a big concern, because country level issues are something that managerial politics can solve, whereas individual is what psychologists do. So let me just remind you that self-efficacy and anxiety retain the same sign at both individual and country level in PISA. Self-concept changes the sign, and there are many other constructs that we have not, that Jihyun has just looked at, listed down, that in fact are a small correlation with achievement, but they become large correlation, negative correlation, like self-concept at the country level, when you look at it at the country level. Okay, what are the anchoring vignettes? They were proposed in 2005-2006 by some survey researchers as a way of modifying the scores to take account about in bias responding, various other things related to it. And here's they usually consist of two or three sentences describing a behavior of some kind or anything related to the actual measure that you use to assess your own performance. In this case, it has to do with classroom management. The vignette that they use in this classroom management, there are three versions of this, and they use that to modify all the scores in other things, not just classroom management. So the students in Mr. Young's class frequently interrupt his lessons. As a result, he often arrives 5 minutes late to the class. Mr. Young is in control of his class, and the kids have to say whether they agree with that or not, just on the basis of that skill. That's not this young. He's my boss, I wouldn't dare play with him. Okay, these are the vignettes, so it is just an idealized kind of a teacher. Okay? It could be anything, any of the other constructs that are, they chose the classroom behavior. An item from the classroom management scale, which is related to that, asks, my own teacher is in control of his classroom. So what the way they use the anchoring vignettes is much more complex than what I have here in the example, but basically the idea is the same. That is, they use the vignette in order to modify your own answer to represent what you think about the world in large, about the teacher in this particular case. So what they do is then the person has agreed that Mr. Young is a good in control, and then he disagrees that his own teacher is like that. And what they do is then modify the score for the teacher that is given by the student, so that it reflects his attitude towards the general teaching and the general stance. And the scale, in fact, as you can see, what they do is 2 is there, 3 is here, 2.5 to modify the answer in that way. There are 7 items in the scale that they used, 7 categories here altogether. The scale, in fact, was 1 to 7. I'm just doing it in order to illustrate to you how the scoring was basically done. So what you do is modify the actual answers. And here's what happens then. As I said before, when you have the individual items, here is the self-concept, there is the scale that was used to modify for the vignettes and used in the way that I have just described. These are all the other variables that they used in PISA to try to modify, to change it, because they have observed that when they go to the country level, just use these 63 countries as units and correlate with achievement for those countries, then all of these correlations become negative. That is what Jihyun showed you. And when you modify the items using those vignettes in the way that I have just described, the scales all reverse back to what individual correlations are like. These are the correlations with the modified scales. And they said, well, there is something happening there if you take into account the culture. I'll come to that in a minute. But what I perhaps want to point out now is that it is not just mathematics self-concept that behaves in that negative way. There's a whole host of variables that exist there, and I would like to suggest that whatever you try to use to interpret the negative correlation and modify here and work with the self-concept, you should take into account these other things as well, or dismiss it in some way if you can. But the correlations are the same. The paper that Jihyun and I have just written is in fact arguing with some of our colleagues at ETS, because even though you can do these vignettes and make change the scoring at the country level, what turns out to be the case, the nature of the factors that come out from these 12 or so variables completely changed. There were three meaningful factors with the non-anchored items, and they all become one single scale. And the when you anchor them, and that they did not pay attention to that as much. It is a big interpretational problem if you try to. They are no longer the same measures that they used to be prior to anchoring, in my opinion. Okay, so. When Phil talked about, I was reminded of a paper that I read a couple of years ago, published in the Journal of Cross-Cultural Psychology, and what they were talking about is a self-concept, but in science, PISA 2006, and they were pointing out that at the country level, they used hierarchical linear modeling with some of the constructed variables that they used to represent various things. They came to the conclusion that at the country level, findings were consistent with the idea that people are comparing themselves, these negative correlations come because people are comparing themselves to some kind of educational benchmarks, to standards and norms. And also, what was playing the role in those negative correlations is the response styles. Some countries tend to endorse only the middle part of the scale, not to stick out. And so they found out that at the country level, those negative correlations should be interpreted in terms of the comparison. But they also talked about the school level. They were doing the analysis at both school level, using schools in several countries within each country. And they did point out that selective schools, as Phil told us, are showing largely. But they refused to talk about the same effects playing their role at both levels. I don't know how does that fit in with anything in this world. I just thought I forgot about that paper, so I looked it up, and I thought I'll bring it to your attention again here. I want also to talk to you about my favorite subject. Nobody thinks it is important, but I think it is. Having to do with the confidence as we measure it in some of our work. How do we measure confidence? This is an item from the letter series test. Find out what number comes next in the series, letter series 8 in this particular case. And after each item, I did not invent that. That comes from the work of economists, Kahneman, and that crowd there. After each item, you ask them how sure you are that your answer was correct. Remember, in self-efficacy, you ask whether you think you can do it. This time, you ask after the act whether you can do it. The correlation between self-efficacy and this kind of measure is about 0.60, around 0.60. So it is not perfect correlation. You think you can do it, but it, in fact, when you do it, you change your opinion a bit. In this kind of work, accuracy, percentage of corrects in a test, and confidence is the average of the items that average of all the confidence ratings across the items in the test. So you can compare them directly, whether how confident you are with how accurate you are. Okay, sorry about that, Liz. The reason why I think confidence is important is in one of our Singaporean studies, we correlated the accuracy with different measures of self-confidence, anxiety, the TIMSS measures. And as you can see, the correlation that between accuracy and confidence is 0.69. That is a little bit more than what we usually get. Between 0.40 and 0.60 is the correlation of confidence with the accuracy on the same test. This is a little bit higher. But you can see that it is higher than efficacy, anxiety, and all these other measures that still do have notable correlations. And when we then try to use them in the regression analysis to predict the actual accuracy scores, it turns out that the only thing that is significant is confidence. All these other things are swamped, okay, taken over. And you will know why soon. So, but confidence remains, everything else goes down. Predictive validity of confidence, we correlated the accuracy and all these other self-belief measures with the school marks, Okay, 6 months later, they were schoolmarked. Remember, the accuracy is the measure of mathematics achievement, and that should be the best. Predictor 0.66 in this data, mass confidence 0.55, and then you have all these other measures as that coming there. The highest correlations are there, and then we used the data without math accuracy to predict the school grade 6 months later. And as you can see, confidence is the strongest predictor. Math anxiety is also a strong predictor. And memory self-concept, that disappeared later on. We use it with some IQ type working memory measures. And then when you put the accuracy in, math accurate together with all the others in the predicting equation, math accuracy takes 0.48, and that should be the best predictor of them all. It is the cognitive performance. But you can see that self-confidence remains still significant, and also anxiety, everything else is not in there. This is one of our data sets published in 2013 or 14, I don't know. Okay, there you are. Now, what I'm leading to is the idea that there is a set. Did you want to ask?
Just a quick question. When you control for previous performance, does the confidence variable still predict?
Yes. Yes. The way, since you asked it, I'll go on a tangent. what we find out is that there's a general confidence factor, and in fact, you can use any kind of test, calculate confidence, and that would be probably the best non-cognitive predictor of any other cognitive test. Okay? And that is why I think it is important. Nobody believes.
I believe it.
What I'm leading to, as I indicated earlier, is that there is a broad self-belief factor, and I think it is important. All these things, self-concept, self-efficacy, anxiety, and confidence that has been neglected are all important, and they do define the same factor. In the PISA 2003, correlation between anxiety and self-concept that we've obtained was minus 0.673, very high correlation, and similar here, the lowest correlation is put minus 268, and remember that is the item-based measure. And that's self-concept and self obviously, these are not zero correlations like those that I mentioned at the beginning. There is something in common. And then only yesterday I decided to push Jihyun to use these variables that she talked about earlier. From PISA 2003, she didn't want to do it in 2012 as well. But when you run the analysis, then you obtained two factors, the self-belief factor here with the three things, and also the composition SES factor with the repeat class people having a negative correlation, as you would expect. So self-beliefs should be studied. Why is confidence important? Okay, another 5 minutes. Correlations with other self-beliefs, as we have seen, are high. When used to predict achievement, it is the best predictor, and it has incremental validity over other cognitive measures. It reduces predictive variance of the other self-beliefs. And about 10 years ago, the big issue at TTS was how to measure personality and prevent faking, cheating, because they were interested in using the test of personality for personnel selection, and if people know how to do it, and they have big problems with it, I shouldn't say that, with some groups. And turned out, what I believe to be the case, confidence cannot be faked easily. What you have to do is look at the item and say how confident you are. You cannot say I'm more confident than you look stupid or underconfident. So this is among the non-cognitive measures that is probably the best non-fakeable measure that I know of. I didn't bring this up earlier. Now, the importance of it, and that is what brought me onto it. Remember, I was not an educational psychologist in 1990s when I started doing that work. I was interested in decision-making and behavior decision-making, and some of the work that came out of Gigerenz's work, of the work of Kahneman and Tversky and so on. And I was interested in finding out if those measures that they use relate to IQ. And how do they relate to it? So at the time, there was a lot of talk about the so-called overconfidence. There's still a lot of talk about it, and in particular about the overconfidence bias. And I'll tell you in a minute what it is. Daniel Kahneman, about a year ago, made me very happy. He was interviewed for the Guardian in the United Kingdom, and they asked him, if you had a magic wand, what kind of bias would you get? Would you wish to get rid of? He said, overconfidence bias. By all means, that is the worst thing that we have, because of the findings that I will mention in a minute. Now, just to bring this again, confidence does not show the negative correlation at the country level. So out of the four self-beliefs, only self-concept shows that, which is very important and very interesting in my opinion, should be understood. This is IRT analysis of a test in which, this is only one item, the red circles are ability measures, the item number three, and how the way I think about it is, imagine that this is the total score that people have on a test, a low score, this is the high score, and this is how they answered, what is the plot of the proportion of the accurate answers for each one of these groups. So zero should correspond to 50% accuracy and so on. Basically, what you can see, and this top part are the confidence corresponding to the people belonging to each one of these groups, which means that the group that has a low score, and that holds for the test, for this item in particular, for other items, and it depends whether the item is difficult or not, and so on. All this plays its role. But the basic finding is that if people who have most difficulties appear to be the most overconfident, they think that they know more. The difference is large there, and it becomes, sometimes this one goes even under confidence. The high-ability people think that this item is so easy that they might have missed something and put themselves low when they ask the judge how they do. I don't know how much that happens, but that is what some people told me. Okay, and what we did then is, in a recent cross-cultural study, we have the same graph for the countries, but these are the world regions. The Southeast Asia had the lowest IQ score of the measure that we used, which was that number series test that I had before. Then Sub-Saharan Africa, South Asia, and so on. East Asia, as is usually the case with the TIMSS and PISA data, scored the highest. Angles are below them. And notice that even there is a difference between the confidence and accuracy. What is interesting is that all these countries, your confidence is pretty much the same across these different regions, and is similar in shape to the individual thing that I had a minute ago, even more pronounced. So the individual and country overconfidence is showing the same trend. Low-scoring countries are more overconfident than high-scoring country, and by overconfidence I mean the difference between the two curves.
Exactly.
Yes.
If somebody doesn't answer the question, is that missing data removed from the analysis? So, say they have a question,
yes.
10 times larger than, like, I don't know.
Yes.
Does their confidence start getting included in?
No, not that I know. not in this, I'd have to go back and think about it. But the data that we use usually are screened for things like that. Okay, let me know. So let me go on. Some accounts of overconfidence. Some business people are saying that this is the result of self-enhancement tendencies, and there are several articles in the Journal of Social Psychology, presenting social psychology, arguing that it is the result of trying to boost yourself. I am a big guy. Cognitive bias is another interpretation that is quite common, and in fact it is related to what Kruger and Dunning called, what is it called?
The Dunning-Kruger effect.
Yes, overconfidence is sometimes interpreted in those terms. People who have low ability do not have the ability to understand how low they are, and they think that they are better. I had a sentence back at the beginning saying that Jihyun made me take it out. I don't believe. I stick out among my intelligence people. They ostracized me for a while because I don't think that intelligence cannot be changed. They all thought that way. I do not. So I think that what is happening is this is a survival mechanism. And Philip Ackerman in 1990s proposed the distinction between typical performance and maximal performance. On tests, you are asked to do maximal performance, but most of our life is spent by not working on the tests. We just try to get around and so on. So we build up our confidence about our life and all. So overconfidence, I think, is a survival mechanism, basically. That is why some of these countries and some of the people, and good of them, I mean, we don't want to make them go into the ground because they are unhappy. As far as confidence interventions are concerned, we need to improve calibration. People need to understand better how good they are when they make a decision. And I say that very seriously because if you people with low ability, in some of our work with Vietnam veterans, people kill themselves on the road. People commit suicide if they have low cognitive ability, and some people risk too much when and are overconfident when they have a low ability. So we should try to make people more better calibrated in what they are doing, and not only low scoring people on ability tests, but there is quite a lot of interest in overconfidence in the medical decision-making, military decision-making, managerial decision-making. That is what is driving the work on overconfidence. And what can be done? How do we understand what is happening? I tried at one time to use feedback after each item, so it did not quite work. What we should do, perhaps, is try to teach people about errors. How do they make errors and make them cognizant of the fact that sometimes they think that they have done well, they have not, and then make them aware. There is some evidence that that is happening, but I think much more needs to be done. Prolonged feedback coupled with raising awareness of cognitive biases and so on. I'm sorry that this presentation took a bit longer, and thanks for listening to all this stuff. Jihyun made me change PS for this.
Yes. Confidence is a survival mechanism. It seems like there's something more complicated happening there. Because, you know, with nonverbal animals, the prime directive is to survive, right? And it seems like overconfidence would be a bad trait to have if survival was such a high priority. So what is it about humans that overconfidence would be needed here? It seems like it would be dangerous. It wouldn't be selected for evolutionarily.
Yes. Yes. I have no comment. I think it is an interesting issue. Joseph, I'm not as enamored by evolutionary psychology as some of my colleagues in intelligence.
In relation to that, Bandura's argument is that the optimal self efficacy is slightly positively biased.
Yes.
But clearly not linear. I mean, he would argue the same as you, that it's only slightly.
Yes.
And that has motivational consequences.
Yes. That is what I'm saying as well.
Yeah.
I want it reduced, especially about medicals making diagnosis and military men going into the fight, and among the people with low abilities, but not got rid of it. Otherwise, you know, everybody would be like some of the people I know, just scared of doing anything.
I was curious about some of those earlier slides that from the TIMSS and the PISA data that included educational aspiration as a proxy for, I think, self-belief is what
yes.
you were saying at the time.
Yes. Yeah, there was only one item.
One
yeah.
item. I was curious about the content of the item, because in that body of literature, valuing and aspiring and striving are sort of incorrectly talked about synonymously. So I wondered what the phrasing of that question was.
I cannot tell you.
How far do you want to go for your education from finish high school, college, or beyond college?
So not how important that was, just how far.
So how far?
Yes. Yes, and if you have not noticed that, this was in 2003. It was dumped in 2012.
In 2009, some countries,
and then
you put
them
again.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
And always just one item each time it was used. Yeah.
Yeah.
It just the placing of it was a little bit stupid. I think that's why it got dropped, because the question right before is how far, what is your parents' education level, and then the next one is how far do you want to go. So yeah, it's just a little too yeah. yeah. If it was the beginning or the end, he was writing work, but after right after asked her parents, said, then what about you? So it was kind of stupid, come down again for sure.
Did you look at the PISA confidence items? I mean, it's quite different than what you're doing, but it's somewhat related. I think it was just 1 year, but maybe it was more than one, where they asked them about test items. How?
It was with science. Not we have focused
yeah.
here with mathematics, but that was with science. And Gianna has looked at it more. Do you want to?
It's only in 2006 with science, but that is in a separate data file that I've been kind of chasing after it. But then, yeah, I haven't really done it.
Did you correlate it?
No, I haven't done it because it's not in the public data file. I have to chase it after the other step. It's a, like. Yeah, it's not in the domain,
public
domain.
Yeah, sure. Lazar, I have a question with the TIMSS and PISA. I was thinking, you do the HLM models and then rank them by standardized beta, and that's a measure of conditional importance, but I wondered whether you guys considered doing a dominance analysis or a parameter or an algorithm or something like that to get it importance.
You have to teach me that. The thing is, I really don't much care, to be frank with you. I told Kerb about it. There was interest in me, similar to his in following up methodological developments. But I kind of, as I was dealing with different people in my life, kind of moved back. I thought the correlations tell you a lot. You know, after doing everything that I have done, I can probably look at the correlation matrix and tell you how many factors and what the factors are going to be. Done that. Okay. So correlations are simple to describe. The other thing that I have evolved over the years is something that is becoming popular nowadays: replicability of psychological findings. I felt for the past 20 years that we should not pay attention to small Mickey Mouse significance. And correlations are telling me very important. These are direct relations. Some of the stuff, frankly, I do like the idea of mediators and moderators and all that, but I have a feeling that many of these will not replicate, given the reliability of psychological measures. And I had a reputation, I didn't know about it, back in 1980s, when I was doing stuff with intelligence and developing measures of working memory and looking at the complexity effects and all that. What was happening at the same time, there was an Army Institute trying to replicate findings by people like myself and my colleagues and so on. Ackerman was there were quite a few other people. This is what they say, let's see if we can replicate. I had the reputation of having the best replicability in the crowd. And that is mostly because significance is there, but the effect size is much more important, and the larger, the better. We should not talk about incidency, but they are not going to replicate. And making a big story about it is just not something that I want to
Yeah, that's not quite what the dominance analysis. I mean, I think the dominance analysis is more about which variables will predict in a subsequent data set. And when I've done that, it's only for attainment, not for achievement. Nothing but socioeconomic status holders.
Well, I would like to see that, yes. For PISA?
Yeah. For ELSA.
What?
ELSA, because it will be attainment at the university degree, not achievement.
I would like to see that. Send me the paper if you have it, and I would like to apply to some of these data. It makes sense, but those correlations are convincing enough, and the stronger the better. And some of the stuff that is not working for this particular area. Now, I'm not saying that it is for other things it is not. Of course, it is important. Just psychopathology measures are important, but not for doing this. And if you're interested in this, then get rid of a lot of work. I would say some of the work. I want people may. Knock my paper back in future if I say something.
It surprises us because we put the SCS as a benchmark to be highest one, and then we wanted to compare to non-cognitive. And then when we did the HLM, actually the size of was nearly reversed. So
it's
that
also
actually,
water, is it? I mean, socioeconomic status is exogenous to those things. So.
All of that. I would like to learn.
When I wrote about the paradoxical difference correlation kind of thing that you're talking about, I came up with two perspectives. One is the frame of reference, but that can't explain it. That can explain some of it away, but it obviously can't explain all of it. The other thing that I came up with is that it's sort of a feedback mechanism. The more critical feedback you get is good for your achievement, but it's bad for your self-concept. Particularly in a place like some of the Southeast Asian countries where the feedback is maybe constructive, but it's pretty cruel, or at least pretty harsh. So I think that there's something there. And there's also, I know I was looking, what was interesting to me was I was looking at Saudi Arabia and some of the countries there where there's almost no feedback. And the self-beliefs are extraordinarily high, and the ability levels, the achievement levels are extraordinarily low. And in that one, it was interesting that there, for the TIMSS, the eighth grade sample was more or less like the fourth grade sample in most other countries in terms of the relationship with self-confidence, some of the feedback sorts of stuff. So maybe they were getting more feedback as they get older.
That is very important. What I think, as I said earlier, let me reiterate again, is that these negative correlations are not just in self-concept, so I'm not surprised that comparison with the others. Maybe in comparison with the standards in the society should be considered. That is one individual idea. Instead of, you know that people behave to, and to me, this negative correlation, understanding that is the most interesting at the moment. As you know, I have looked at the cross-cultural differences in social norms, personality, and various other things. What is coming out with this positive-negative correlation, I think that is indicating something of the major cross-cultural effects that are just popping up, and we need to understand very much. Your idea about feedback, yes, but I think just like comparison, the reason why I started jumping down when I saw all these other negative correlations at the country level is that some of them cannot be understood in terms of comparisons. And they are just, of the kind that we think about in education. There are other things that are operating in, and it is telling us these correlations, the change from individual to the other, it is telling us about some important cross-cultural differences that are sitting out there, and the people in the world, for managers, politicians, should know about it, and focus on that if they want to implement the policy measures.
And the feedback variable is very, very complex, as you can imagine. It really takes a lot of system-level kind of input to actually measure the feedback. It's very, very hard. It's not like the fact that I wasn't a psychologist. The reason that I became sort of psychologist because it doesn't get too much influenced by the other factors, but like feedback, teacher feedback is very, it's just school level, it's just, for instance, even Asia, like where I grew up, because our class size is 70, so even in Korea, I've got never feedback in my life until I went to America, so it's similar to Saudi, but then we don't have that effect that you see in Saudi. So it's just, it's very, very complex variable. And if you're interested, actually, in PISA 2012, there is a scale level feedback, teacher feedback. But they label it as teacher's formative assessment. And the correlation is actually minus at the individual level. So that's why we kind of, in the first round, the variable got cut off, because minus 0.3 at the individual level. So the student who feels that they have more feedback has to score lower on mathematics.
How did you score the TIMSS items? Because that's a real mess, because they've got their scale scores that are terrible. And then you can just take the average of the items, it's a much better scale score, or you could take a latent variable. Yeah. And each of those will give you quite different responses.
Yeah. TIMSS is total mess, as you got the PISA, they already did the scale levels, it's very nice and comfy, but actually, since 2003, they're adding more and more scale level. I think they copied PISA, so they started already in the disease, PISA did copy, so actually, the ones that have joined the okay correlations, they actually in all the scale level that the TIMSS actually developed. So they're about like half they actually put in the TIMSS, and about half I make them scale.
I was thinking about, I was really surprised and pleasantly surprised to see the confidence predicting over and above previous achievement. I was wondering if you could just give us a rundown of what like the mechanism is that, like, what is confidence doing to promote future achievement?
Your guess is as good as mine. I think there are significant individual differences in confidence. So, and I think some of our are more confident than the others. I really don't know. And I don't want to BS, just to come around. If your guess is about as good as... What I do know is that it works. And if we can come up with it, the understanding, I would be more than happy. But I cannot give you the easy answer.
One of the aspects that intrigues me about your work, and I understand that there's partially a way of looking at it, but your unidimensionality of confidence. If you ask me your confidence kind of items about being a novel mechanic, it'll be very low. And if you ask me about psychometrics, depending on what frame of reference I happen to be using that day, it'll certainly be higher than the other.
Okay, can I stop you? Can I stop you here?
Sure.
That's not what I'm talking about. And maybe this is a good opportunity for me to change your frame of reference.
Okay.
Remember, and there has just been a study published where they look at the confidence as I measure it. And confidence of the kind that you're talking about, confidence in doing something.
No, I'm not talking about something. You can give me an item, and I can do it. And then you can say, how confident am I that I got it right? And
yes.
If it's auto mechanics, my confidence will be very low.
Yeah.
And if it's psychometrics, it's going to be it's going to be high.
Yes, but at the same time.
Your ability will be also high.
Yes, your ability
right.
will be also
high.
Yes.
Yeah,
so,
your confidence level doesn't take into account ability.
Among the people who are doing the same task that you are doing, the mechanical task, you will be standing at the same level in terms of confidence as you stand on your mathematics achievement. That is what I was talking about. So, how confident you are in doing, among all the people doing both of the tasks, your position on different cognitive tasks relative to the other people will remain the same. That is the G factor. That is, frankly, I did not want to talk about it, but now that you are raising it, the only general factor, and I have, Jihyun made me take off the examples of the items that I have used. Perceptual tasks, the verbal tasks, the IQ kind of tasks of any kind. You give them the items and you ask them for their confidence. Confidence from these different tasks defines a separate factor from accuracy. And it is a general factor. That is why Joseph's question is the way answered the way I did. Having confidence on one task is a better predict, and you don't know anything else about the person, and you want to predict how is that person going to do some other task. It will be.
No, I do understand because we've talked about this numerous times, and one of the things that I find quite fascinating is that something. Totally unrelated tasks like auditory ability will load on the same factor as mathematical ability and
confidence in the task.
Yes, I understand.
Yes.
Yeah. And that's what I don't understand, and that's what I find fascinating.
I think so.
Yeah.
This came as a surprise.
Yeah.
About up to now, Sabina would say 20 studies showing the same thing. I would not say that many, but study after study, and you can have for Joseph's question, you have four measures of confidence, four tests, four accuracy, four confidence from the same tests. They define different factors, but when you look at the diagonal of the square matrix where they match, they're all pretty much the same. What is interesting is that showing that the correlation of confidence on one of the tasks is higher than the correlation with some other task than some of the other. It just blew my mind, the way it is coming up. we need to understand it. It is the your frame of reference is an important concept, but the empirical evidence with the confidence. We should try this. Physical.
No. I can see because the frame of reference has relatively little effect on a pure self-efficacy, which is closer to what where it's a specific item.
Yes. Yeah. Now let me bring one more issue out again. Notice that among the three self beliefs, that closeness to the items is important because both confidence and self efficacy have that feature. But there is anxiety that in our work is showing the same correlation with achievement, negative correlation as self-efficacy, but that is not item related. It is just general kind of thing. So we can push this closeness to the actual task only that much. When I used to talk about intellect and openness in personality, it had the same kind of feel. I think it is very interesting. I'm so glad that I went to Singapore and started looking at these self-beliefs. They are obviously coming out as important things, but what we should do is look, in my opinion, and I may be wrong many times of that, we should look at what is in common there. These self-beliefs are ignored in the typical personality psychology, and they go on with emotional intelligence and things like that. This is very strong, and we should focus more in trying to understand what is happening.
So that is that the confidence measure maps closely to the cognitive test, and then that can then predict quite generally things that are quite different from that cognitive test. So is there like a this is like a 20-item measure, which would allow you to get this kind of G factor of confidence that you could then use to create lots of other things.
You don't have to get a G factor.
A good small,
small
version of this.
You know, this measure of number series that I showed to you. I use it many times in the past. It is a measure of fluid intelligence. When I designed this study with Gerard Saussier, I gave him a 10-item beta serious test. And him being all into the wishy-washy personality measurement, sorry guys, he decided that it is too hard. He has never given an IQ test in the questionnaire, so he cut it. Five items is enough for Lazar Stankov. I thought, oh, there we go, nothing. And then when I looked at, as you have seen, at the regions, world regions, and overconfidence, it worked as good as anything. You can pick up virtually any paper and pen, use some of my GFGC key test items, and you will get a measure of confidence that is a general thing.
And it's reliable for 5 or 10 items?
It is, yes. Not 5 or 10. I would say not 5. I would still argue it did show reliable. Reliability sufficient for Cronbach alpha. But I was just scared to no end, and then it worked. If you use any of my GFGC items there, you will be as good as anything. Done many times.
What's the correlation between confidence and SES?
And what?
I associate on the SES.
Can't tell you. You see, the socio-economic status we talk about is from PISA, and confidence has never been used with PISA. And in my own work, we did measure parental education, but I cannot tell at this stage. It was never.
At the time we did it, because in Singapore, for some reason, you can never ask about race, you can never ask about parents, so it was
yes. Audience,
so the basic
ones
were not in the
basic. Yes. Sorry. Any other question? Holy gosh, you would have.
Thank you. Thank you.